one.
Hello, I'm Janet Neal, and I'd like to welcome you to today's presentation on ChemADVISOR's EHS authoring tools. For those of you not familiar with ChemADVISOR, since we were founded in 1986, our goal has been to be an indispensable source of EHS-AT information to our customers and business partners. We accomplish this in a variety of ways, including analyzing global EHS-AT laws and literature, then providing that information through databases and consulting services, including global registration services, hazard assessments, SDS authoring and training courses, just to mention a few. Our products include the LAWLE regulatory database, which you can access in several ways, including a fully hosted version, relieving you and your IT staff of the need to host the application and apply updates. We also have the Transportation Advisor and Pure Substance databases. And if you need to do the occasional quick lookup for information on a chemical, there's ChemADVISOR Online, where you have access to LAWLE, transportation, and the pure substance databases all in one place. Our global chemical regulatory reports provide chemical regulatory requirement summaries for today's largest and most important economies to help you plan and support your product activities around the world. And now, EHS authoring tools. This is the latest generation of ChemADVISOR's authoring systems, created by SDS authors for SDS authors. So whether your needs are for a product line shipped to a single country or many product lines shipped around the world, EHS authoring tools has the data, features, and flexibility required to meet your needs in the ever-changing EHS-AT area. Let's start by taking a look at the data that drives this system. Of course, there are many types of data required when creating an SDS or related document. So we're pleased to include ChemADVISOR's LAWLE database as part of the new system, giving you an enormous amount of information immediately available when you begin using EHS-AT. The LAWLE database is ChemADVISOR's cornerstone product and is a collection of regulatory and advisory information on chemical substances from nearly 4,800 lists and includes phys-chem data and toxicological data in addition to the regulatory data. And LAWLE also has a broad geographic scope, covering over 115 countries. In addition to the regulatory data found in LAWLE, EHS-AT also supports the use of ChemADVISOR's Transportation Advisor database, providing you with proper shipping names, packing groups, and other information from these many sources listed on. Let's move on to some of the features of the EHS-AT system, and begin with templates. Templates cover the way a document looks, defining the layout and the sections, but also how and what regulatory data appears on the document. For example, you may have U.S. data available for a substance, but the EU CLP template would filter that data and not present it on your EU CLP SDS. Templates can define many types of documents, including SDSs, label statements, summary documents, and other documents you may define yourself. EHS-AT comes with several GHS SDS templates, including OSHA, EU CLP, and the UN Purple Book. Now let's move to rules. Rules are a very powerful tool in EHS-AT, allowing the system to populate many sections of the document for the user, providing efficient and repeatable document creation. Rules may function to look up data based on the individual components, such as occupational exposure limits that you'd see in Section 8 of an SDS. Rules may perform calculations based on product and component data to classify a material, say for GHS or under WMIS. Or, based on the information from lookups or calculations, the rules may populate sections of the SDS with phrase text, such as hazard statements in Section 2 or first aid statements in Section 4. The rules can be global. They may be business specific, something that you define to address rules required at your business unit or product level line level. or even user specific in case you perhaps would be doing testing, so you need an individual rule run out there. Here you can see examples of some of the rules that are present in the software. Most of these are lookup type rules, those based on component information from the Lolly database, but the GHS selected set of rules that you see populate phrase text in section 2 of the SDS based on GHS classification rule results, selecting the appropriate symbols, signal word, hazards, and precautionary statements for each product classification. And of course, the software also has those GHS classification rules that I just mentioned. Rule output is specific to each country's implementation of GHS, dropping or rolling up hazard categories as appropriate. Now let's look where rules are created. This rules editor view shows the GHS flammable liquids rule, showing the variables and data types that are considered along each step. Once rules editor functionality is learned and understood, rules can be written, updated, or removed by users without IT or ChemADVISOR assistance. Input for rules comes from product data, as well as the regulatory data for components present in a mixture. This rule shows incorporating product level data with toxicological endpoints. These source information options, where a rule like GHS acute toxicity may pull information from in order to function and minimize or eliminate data gaps. And now let's move to the phrase library and translations. EHS-AT comes with an English phrase library. The phrases can be used, applied, or corrected across multiple SDSs. Phrases are organized by section and subsection to help you efficiently select phrases. You can search by keyword, and then selected phrases will appear in the bottom grid as you select them. Company-specific or product-specific phrases can also be added. Right now, as you see, our user interface is in English, and all the phrases are from the English phrase library that I mentioned before, shown at the top half of the screen. If you have them available, you can select other languages or phrases in other languages from the phrase library to your right. While the English is the selected languages, all phrases in the library show a green button beside them, indicating, of course, that all of these phrases are available in the English phrase library. The same is true on the bottom of the screen, except instead of a button, the entire phrase shows up as green, as you see for the two phrases selected in the selected phrase section. Now let's see what happens when we change both drop-downs to display Japanese translations. On the top half of the screen, the phrase library display remains in English, but note the gray button now, the one with the arrow next to it. The gray indicates the phrase does not have a Japanese translation already available. On the bottom half of the screen, phrases with available Japanese translations display in the green font, and the phrase itself is now displayed in Japanese. And so you'll see that the phrase above, the if inhaled phrase, is one that's not available translated into Japanese at this point. Now let's move to some product data and begin with composition. EHS-AT's composition section allows you to differentiate between confidential and non-confidential compositions, roll up composition from raw materials, import composition from Excel files, and maintain in-use composition for byproducts produced during processing. For example, we're on the composition detail screen and have a product with multiple components. When the CAS number is entered, the system looks up and associates the chemical name from Lolly. And now we'll move over on to the composition rollup tab, and this is showing what will appear on the SDS. The display name, and here it's defaulting to the primary name from Lolly, as you'll see, you have multiple choices though that you can choose from. Similarly, you can see the display percentage for each component and the percentage that will be used for calculations. This is also where you set display details or restrictions on display for each component on any document generated from this record. You can see that the suppressed components are grayed out. That would be the first component and the two bottom components on the screen. Now let's continue and note at the bottom you'll see the product properties tab, button rather. Properties for the product as a whole are maintained separately from the substance specific details that we looked at above. When product testing has occurred, the resulting information can be entered at the appropriate endpoints, as you see here, and the product data will override any component-driven or rule-driven information in calculations and in putting together the regulatory document, whether it's the SDS or label statements that you may be creating or other documentation. Information that's been added by a user is noted with the overridden remark that you see for both of these. This makes it very easy to identify when you have added data and it's not data that was supplied by the system. Now we'll go back to the composition editor and focus on the component details. Now the details for each component can be reviewed individually by selecting the details item for each row. Component specific details, again, are provided from Lolly. For each component, details such as related CAS numbers from Lolly can be identified to pull in additional data. Component-specific identifiers, such as molecular formula or regulatory numbers, including those from the European Commission, the Japan Industrial Safety and Health Law, the EU Annex 6, or the UN, and others can be captured and maintained here. And if they're published by a regulatory source, they'll be populated by the system automatically. Also, you'll see here under properties, physical, chemical, toxicological and ecotox properties are captured. When any items on this editor is selected, the extended details are displayed in the details screen on the middle right side of the page. So here you're going to see the expanded details for auto ignition. If your company has data for any endpoint, that information can be entered or added, and the entry will be identified again with the overridden remark that we mentioned on the previous screen. The last window on the screen is for classification data. Here, we're capturing GHS classification details across any and all regions of the implementation that have implemented GHS that have actually published classifications. Sometimes you'll find that multiple values may exist for a single endpoint. A hierarchy has been established in the software, but you may wish to and can select a different endpoint or add your own data. By clicking that arrow to the right side as I did of any endpoint where the multiple values are indicated, all the available data can be reviewed and you may make a selection. The default or selected value is highlighted in dark blue font to separate it from the other available values. Note that the details for the value are again on this screen to the right, the details screen. Now if you look at the bottom grid, you'll also see that transportation is there as a selection next to the classification line, but it's not active on this component screen since transportation is assigned at the product level. So we'll move back again to the product details. You can add a UN number by right-clicking on any of the UN number slots you see on the screen and then simply entering the number. And that will allow you then to automatically populate the UN number across all the grid that you see below. And at that point, when you get details, the proper shipping name and classifications are automatically populated. Now, you'll see this is another example where multiple data values are available for a single endpoint. Again, click on that arrow to the right of the endpoint, and you'll be able to review and select from those available options. Now, this is a good opportunity to introduce the WYSIWYG view that EHS-AT provides. When the WYSIWYG option is selected from the menu, you get a new screen, a separate window, showing you the what you see is what you get option, essentially a preview, and it opens side by side so you can view along with the main editor. The WYSIWYG window also can be moved to the side remain open as changes are made in the editor, immediately illustrating how the change you've just made would impact the published document. In the WYSIWYG view, the option to view the document in other languages is also available. This time, though, when a translation is not available, the phrase text is highlighted in yellow. So here we have the English phrase that is not available in Japanese highlighted in yellow so you can see readily where you have the missing phrase. The WYSIWYG view has a tab for the section, which is the one that we're in, showing you just the small piece of the document that you're actively working on in the editor. In this case, this is the first aid inhalation section. Now you can move to the SDS view, and it switches to illustrate that small section, but we're now putting it into how it fits in the SDS as a whole. Again, when viewing in a non-English language, the phrases that need translation are highlighted in yellow. Now let's look at versioning and output. In EHS-AT, draft and final status documents are maintained for you, and there are several aspects of version control in the system. New versions are automatically incremented for you, and you also have the option to identify whether changes are major, minor, or based on a regulatory change. EHS-AT also provides several document output format options for you to select from. Word, PDF, and HTML are all available. And now let's look at the delivery of EHS-AT. The primary delivery method for EHS-AT is cloud-based. This eliminates the need for you to load the application and database on your server, and ChemADVISOR will provide timely updating of the Lolly database and maintain the application for you. And now it's time for your questions.